The subject of this talk grew from a brief conversation I had with the Orkney-Norway Friendship Association in 2016. I was asked, did I know any Norwegian aviation-related stories that could be used for their newsletter? My initial reply was no, but after further thinking, I remembered seeing a news item on Grampian television several years previous about two pilots from Norway reenacting the first flight across the North Sea that took place 100 years earlier by a Norwegian called Tryggve Gran, of whom I knew absolutely nothing. So I started digging and discovered that flying the North Sea was only part of this man's story. Jens Tryggve Herman Gran was born on the 20th of January 1888 in Bergen, part of an affluent family dominant in the shipbuilding industry. His great-grandfather, Jens Gran Berl, had founded a shipyard in Bergen. This was a big shipyard that still exists today. It became the ship repair facilities for BDS, the Bergen Steamship Company, and during World War II became the main base for a No. 11 German U-boat flotilla and was reputedly the most bombed facility in Norway. Today it specialises in advanced offshore ships, seismic vessels, diving and research vessels. So the Gran family weren't short of a krona or two. Gran's father died when Tryggve was only 5 years old. In 1900, after school in Bergen and Lillehammer, Gran was sent to school in Lausanne, Switzerland for a year, where he learned to speak German and French. 3 years later, he met the German Emperor Wilhelm II, who was a common guest with the families of Tryggve's friends. Meeting the Emperor made an impact on the then 14-year-old, who from then on wanted to become a naval officer. At this time, he had had several years behind him as a member of the New Guards Battalion in Bergen, and he entered Naval College in 1907 and graduated in the spring of 1910. Gran took an interest in science and exploration, which in 1910 led to the explorer Nansen recommending his services to Captain Robert Falcon Scott, who was in Norway at the time, preparing for his expedition to the Antarctic and testing the motor tractors he intended to take with him. Scott was impressed with Gran, who was an expert skier, and Nansen convinced Scott to take Gran as a ski instructor to Scott's men, stating, "But remember, Scott, it's no use having skis unless you know how to use them properly. You ought to take a Norwegian to show you." So not long after, Gran was aboard Scott's ship, the Terra Nova, en route to Antarctica. Arriving in Antarctica early in January 1911, Gran was one of the expedition members involved in the laying of the supply depots needed for the attempt to reach the South Pole later that year. Whilst in Antarctica, Gran felt there was a conflict of interest with his fellow countrymen. Amundsen was in Antarctica at the same time on his expedition to the South Pole, and Scott was less than pleased to have Amundsen there, and heaven forbid, reach the South Pole before Scott did. Gran's diary stated, "He thought the expedition would be ruined. He thought they would be laughed at when they got back and were only a jolly good second." His diary repeatedly mentioned his predicament, being a Norwegian on a British expedition.
15th of April, 1911. Teddy Evans told me today that in a letter Rennick had expressed his conviction that Amundsen would reach the pole first. I have seen some photographs Campbell has sent Scott, including a group picture of the Amundsen expedition. They are nine. Of course, these I have so far only identified Amundsen, Bjaaland, and Johansen. I am not sure whether Gjertsen is among them, but I believe so because a young lieutenant has asked Campbell a lot about me. Campbell had eaten in Amundsen's hut. The hut looks pretty small from the photograph. The Norwegian flag flies from the gable, As to whether this is their winter quarters or not, opinions are divided. Some people believe they went to sea during the autumn storms, others that the cold on the barrier will kill the dogs. I and some others believe his choice of site is in conformity with the whole plan. Everything depends on luck, if it is with them. There are great advantages in that site, for they are a whole degree nearer to the pole than we are here. If luck is against them, it will be disaster. All or nothing is Amundsen's motto, they say, and I agree with him. 18th of April, 1911. At breakfast we discussed Amundsen. Most of those here consider he will reach the pole first, if he is not driven out to sea. Their hut is built on the sea ice right under the barrier. According to the people in Terra Nova, there were cracks between it and the hut, but I am convinced that experienced people like Amundsen and Johansen would not build on unsafe ground if there were better ground to be found. There was absolutely nothing about their plans in the letter to Scott. I have made up my own mind on how Amundsen will strike out for the pole. This year he has made a depot journey south. He will have judged that we have been on Beardmore Glacier. It is difficult to say how far his journey has taken him, but I should imagine it's between latitude 80 and 81 degrees. He is therefore ahead of us. 19th of April, 1911. Today, again, we were discussing Amundsen. I wonder if the world is too. 21st of April, 1911. They are still discussing Amundsen, and I can say nothing. God knows I am in a difficult position, and I hope to avoid the worst predicament by going with the party to the Western Mountains. I really don't want to compete with my compatriots.
Gran and Scott were good companions, and Gran was worried that Scott might ask him to go to the pole. He went to Scott and said,
"If you want me to compete with my countrymen, I will do it. But I think, if you can put me somewhere else, it will be better for me as a Norwegian, because I hate to compete in a thing like this. In a way, it is a national sport for both of us."
Scott understood his predicament and let him go with the Australian geologist, Griffith Taylor, on an expedition to the Western Mountains, while Scott and his party were on their journey to the pole. Scott set off for the South Pole, arriving on the 17th of January 1912, only to discover that Amundsen had got there first, arriving on the 14th of December 1911. It is well documented that Scott never made it back and perished in Antarctica. In November 1912, Gran was part of the search party that found the tent containing the dead bodies of Scott's party. After collecting their personal belongings, the tent was lowered over the bodies of Scott and his two companions, and a 12-foot snow cairn was built over it. A pair of skis were used to form a cross over their grave, and Gran travelled back to the base camp at Cape Evans using Scott's skis, reasoning that at least Scott's skis would complete the journey. Before leaving Antarctica, Gran made an ascent of Mount Erebus with Raymond Priestley and Frederick Hooper in December 1912, an occasion which nearly ended in disaster, when an unexpected eruption caused a shower of pumice blocks to fall around them. When Gran returned to Europe in 1913, the tragedy of Scott's expedition had gripped the public imagination. He's quoted as saying,
"It was almost as if by dying, as he did, Scott had become the real victor, whilst Amundsen had merely won the race."
The establishment and media of the day were very reluctant to acknowledge the achievements of Amundsen over those of Scott. On 24th of July 1913, Gran was awarded the Polar Medal by King George V. Being part of Scott's expedition opened doors and opportunities for him. Gran was introduced to a man called Robert Lorraine. This is the only picture I could find of him, taken from the cover of Vanity Fair. He was the first man to attempt to fly the Irish Sea, and he narrowly failed in his attempt, flying from Holyhead. He was tantalisingly close to to the Irish coast when his engine failed, and he was forced to land in the sea just a mere 200 feet from land and swim ashore. He's credited with inventing the word joystick to describe an aircraft's stick controls. When meeting Gran, he told him, "I think you ought to take up flying. Be a damn sight easier to fly than to do all those things on ice." And Gran took him at his word. Gran went to Louis Bleriot's aviation school in Paris and became a skilled pilot. He joined the Norwegian Army Air Service. And after this, he took on his next challenge when on the 30th of July 1914, Gran became the first pilot to cross the North Sea in a heavier-than-air aircraft. The first flight across the North Sea was inadvertently made in December 1910. Two German balloonists, Herr Distler and Jürdens, set off from Munich on what they thought would be an afternoon trip. The weather changed and they were blown across the North Sea. Their first landfall was Orkney, and they crash-landed in the fields behind Park Cottage in Kirkwall, demolishing a stone dike in the process. After recovering in Kirkwall for a few days, they returned to Germany by steamer. Gran took off in his Bleriot monoplane from the beach at Port Errol near Cruden Bay. There are photographs of him having landed on the golf course above the beach, but I suspect he moved to the beach because of fog. He may have been a good pilot, but he was lousy at checking the weather. It's possible to crudely reconstruct a weather map from the details in his flight log. He took off from the beach, flying along the coast to Peterhead before turning and heading for Stavanger. Very soon, however, he was encountering strong northwesterly winds, which turned into a gale. On top of that, he encountered thick fog. The Bleriot plane was notoriously poor to control, especially in gusts. It had no ailerons and was controlled by wing warping. At one point he was flying at 5,000 feet, and then he was forced down to 100 feet above the sea for most of the journey. To make matters worse, the engine cut out briefly right in the middle of the North Sea. Nearer to Norway, the weather, however, improved and turned into a calm, sunny day. He landed 4 hours and 10 minutes later near Stavanger, after a flight of 320 miles, which is just 1 hour longer than a flight today would take when you allow for going through security and check-in times. The reason he decided to fly this chosen route was that there were plenty of steamships between Peterhead and Stavanger, and he thought that should he get into difficulties and have to ditch in the sea, he'd have a good chance of being picked up. Through the wonders of flight sim and modern technology, we can see a show, a mock-up of a cinema newsreel of the day, to give you an idea of what happened. News of Gran's achievements, however, was quickly forgotten, because only 5 days later the United Kingdom entered the First World War. Gran, who was a first lieutenant in the Norwegian Army Air Service, volunteered for service with the Royal Flying Corps. He was rejected because of Norway's neutrality. However, that rejection didn't stop Gran. He was able to study with the Royal Flying Corps under the identity of Captain Teddy Grant of Canada. And he was admitted to the Royal Flying Corps, serving in 1916 with the No. 39 Squadron on home defence. After release from the Norwegian Army Air Service, Gran was commissioned into the Royal Flying Corps under his own name as a probationary temporary second lieutenant on the 1st of January 1917, and confirmed in the rank and appointed a flying officer on the 1st of March 1917, and was posted to No. 70 Squadron, flying Sopwith Camels on the Western Front. He was appointed flight commander on the 1st of January 1918 with the rank of acting captain, and in March his seniority as second lieutenant was backdated to the 1st of January 1917. Soon after, he was awarded the Military Cross, his citation reading,
"Captain Tryggve Gran, for conspicuous gallantry and devotion to duty. He bombed enemy aerodromes with great success and engaged enemy searchlights, transport and other targets with machine gun fire. He invariably showed the greatest determination and resource."
Gran was shot down in December 1917 during a night test flight. He was wounded in the head, which left him permanently deaf in one ear. He was promoted to acting major on the 10th of September 1918 and commanded various Royal Air Force units in Archangel and Northern Russia during the Allied intervention in 1919. Gran was temporarily transferred to the unemployed list on the 26th of April 1919, but on the 1st of August was granted a permanent commission in the Royal Air Force with the rank of captain. However, this was cancelled on the 2nd of December 1919. Gran finally relinquished his commission on the 6th of August 1921. Gran himself claimed to have shot down the German air ace Hermann Göring in a dogfight on the 8th or 9th of September 1917. He discovered this when he became acquainted with Göring after the war and compared his flight logs with Göring's. It could, however, not be positively verified that it was Gran who shot down Göring's plane. After the war, Gran started holding lectures on aviation and his journeys to the polar areas, as well as writing books. In 1928, he led a search party to find Roald Amundsen, who was lost while flying, trying to discover the fate of Umberto Nobile's North Pole expedition on board the airship Italia. During the Second World War, Gran was reportedly a member of Vidkun Quisling's Nationalist Party, and they used Gran's hero-like status with their war propaganda. And in 1944, a commemorative stamp was issued to mark the 30th anniversary of Gran's flight across the North Sea. It was thought Gran feared reprisals from the pro-German fascist party because of his commitment to the Royal Air Force in the First World War. It was also thought his friendship with Göring and bitterness over not being offered a full-time job in the Norwegian Army Air Service may have been reasons for Gran to support the Nationalist Party during the Nazi occupation of Norway. After a trial in 1948, Gran was found guilty of treason and sentenced to a prison term of 18 months. The remainder of his life was devoted principally to writing books and giving talks, etc. Amongst his other achievements, Gran was also a gifted football player, earning one cap for Norway in 1908. This was Norway's first ever international football match and was played against Sweden in Gothenburg, but Sweden beat Norway 11-3. He also conducted the first night flight in Norway, and in 1919 he was the first man to fly from London to Stockholm. Gran was also involved in the 1919 plan to fly a Handley Page V1500 across the Atlantic from Newfoundland to the UK. This effort ended after the aircraft crashed in the Bay of Fundy and was totally abandoned after Alcock and Brown's transatlantic flight in a Vickers Vimy shortly after. In 1971, the Community Council of Cruden Bay asked a group of Robert Gordon's College senior school pupils to construct a memorial to Tryggve Gran during their projects week. In May 1994, Tom Grieve and Hugh Knox became the first to cross the North Sea in a microlight aircraft, flying from Sunbury in Shetland to Haugesund in Norway, and took 5 hours and 5 minutes. They then flew home via Denmark, Germany, Holland, England, Wales and Ireland. And their flight was planned in order to raise money for Amnesty International and to highlight those countries which didn't enjoy political freedom by touring those which did. In honour of the flight, they were presented with a piece of the fabric from Tryggve Gran's Bleriot aircraft. This fabric now resides at the Museum of Flight at East Fortune near Edinburgh. On the 30th of July 2014, Per Hoyland and Hakon Fosso, two Norwegian microlight pilots, took off from Cruden Bay to reenact Gran's flight across the North Sea exactly 100 years to the day when he made his flight. On board they carried a limited edition bottle of Tryggve Gran whiskey, of which only 60 bottles were made. They were followed by a second aircraft with Herman Gran, Tryggve's son, on board, plus various Norwegian dignitaries. Some of the finer details of Gran's exploits during his lifetime were on occasions compared to those of Baron Munchausen. Munchausen was a semi-fictitious celebrity from the 18th century, noted for telling outrageous tall tales based on his military career. And Gran's descriptions, which were well embellished, didn't always tally with the actual record of events, especially during his time with the Royal Flying Corps. Apart from the moustache and hair, Gran and Munchausen looked remarkably similar. Tryggve Gran died in his home in Grimstad on the 8th of January 1980, aged 91. I wanted to finish this talk by quoting some interesting comment summarising Gran's life, but they are quite hard to find. I did find a paragraph written by a psychologist commenting on Gran's life. He stated, "Strongly ambivalent feelings from the Oedipal period and from the latency may later have been released through hazardous activities, certainly with self-destructive aspects. His membership in Quisling's party might be seen in this context." But the best summary I've come across so far simply reads, "Born Adventurer." And just to finish off is a short film I came across of the first flight of a replica that has been made in Norway of Gran's aircraft, making its maiden flight in September 2016.
kom tillbaka igen.
Ja. Ja, man mötte rätt över herrgården alltså. Hvis de stod I vinduet där så fick det ett fint syn alltså.
Ja, det har vi gjort.
Ja, nydelig. Nydelig.
Ja. Retter vi den opp? Nei, et stykke fortsatt.
Fantastisk. Det helt fantastisk.
Olje over alt.
Ja.
Ja,
det den.
Smulskull. Jeg kunne lukte med å komme ut av bilen, så lukte jeg sin olje.
Champagne og litt ekstra.
Ja.
Har du fått lønn for...